everyone. Welcome to today's live broadcast, characterization of Niemann Pick Type C mutant mice using automated cage monitoring systems. I'm Christina Jewell of LabRoots, and I'll be your moderator for today's event. Today's educational seminar is presented by LabRoots, the leading scientific social networking website and provider of virtual events and webinars advancing scientific collaboration and learning. For more information, please go to www.labroots.com. We have a few important announcements before we begin. This webcast is designed to be interactive, and we encourage you to ask questions during the event. You can submit your questions by typing them in the Q&A box, which can be found by clicking on the green Q&A button at the lower left of the presentation window. We'll try to answer as many questions as we can. You can enlarge the slide window by clicking on the screen icon in the lower right-hand corner of the slide window. Now, if you have any technical problems viewing or hearing this presentation, just click on the support button at the top right of your presentation window, or you can submit your problem through the green Q&A button on the lower left. I would now like to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Sangeetha Iyer. Dr. Iyer received her PhD in molecular pharmacology from the University of Pittsburgh and completed her postdoctoral research at the University of Texas at Austin. Her graduate work focused on development of genetically engineered mouse models for the study of alcohol and anesthetic-induced behaviors. She has over 8 years of experience in model assay development and drug screening for human disorders. At Perlara PBC, she is focused on the nematode drug screening pipeline and design and management of preclinical rodent studies for rare genetic diseases. I will now turn the presentation over to Dr. Iyer. Dr. Iyer?
Thank you, Christy, for that introduction. Today I will be talking to you about some of the work that we've done at Perlara PBC with our Niemann Pick Type C project, specifically about some of the preclinical data that we've collected using automated cage monitoring systems. There we go. Okay. Today my talk will be focused along the following topics. I will start with an introduction about Perlara and the work that we do, and then I will talk a little bit about the background of the disease that we're interested in studying, which is Niemann Pick Type C disease. Some of the prevailing literature about preclinical data on the Niemann Pick Type C mouse model, and then I will switch gears to the data that we collected using automated cage monitoring systems and summarize what that meant for us and our future directions. So to kick this off, Perlara is a drug discovery company. We are located in the Bay Area. We were established in 2014. We are committed to the discovery of small molecule therapeutics for rare genetic diseases. We have a slightly different model than traditional biotech companies in that we partner directly with patient families and advocacy groups to initiate a screening or drug discovery program, which we call the Pearl Quest. Once a Pearl Quest is initiated, Perlara then designs model organisms bearing the mutations responsible for the rare genetic disease of interest. We conduct a drug discovery screening process on these model organisms, and lead candidates that are identified through this process, once they are validated and vetted, we partner with a corporate or a large pharma company in order to advance these drug candidates to the clinic. So our approach is a little different in that we use whole animal models to identify our screening candidates. Once these candidates are identified, they are also validated in patient cells, and once that happens, they are advanced into rodent models or higher model organisms for further toxicology and efficacy studies, and eventually they will be partnered in order to make it to the market. Our approach is non-traditional in that it is unbiased drug screening that we undertake for a lot of these rare genetic diseases. The target, the therapeutic target may not be known prior to the screening process. However, because we use these model organisms that have half a century to a century's worth of developmental biology work on it, we are also equipped with powerful genetic toolkits that we can use recursively to identify the target of the drug. So the rationale or the principle behind this process, behind why this is important, is rare disease, specifically rare genetic diseases, are an underserved or understudied class. Typically, these diseases are multisystemic, so not associated with a single organ type. They affect multiple organs, and they are typically progressive, very harsh, basically course of the disease. While a lot of them arise from a single gene mutation, the spectrum of mutations associated with a particular disease gene can be really large. And at Perlara, what we do is to identify the most prevalent mutational variants and model those in simple model organisms such as fruit flies, nematodes or C. elegans, zebrafish, as well as yeast. And typically, because these genes are incredibly conserved, modeling the disease in these particular systems leads to a strong phenotypic defect. We then use a library of chemical compounds to conduct our screen and identify molecules that reverse the phenotype in these model organisms. Screen hits are then validated in a mammalian cell model, usually a patient-derived cell model. And once that is done, candidates are put through a rigorous in vitro pharmacokinetic profiling step before they are advanced to mouse studies. One of the advantages of using this model organism-based approach is, like I mentioned, because rare diseases are multisystemic and very little is known about their target, this allows us to study the whole disease in a systemic context without being biased towards a particular target. Furthermore, because we are conducting these screens using whole animal models, our screen hits are pre-selected for good pharmaceutical properties such as oral bioavailability, good distribution, low toxicity. Typically, these are the kinds of characteristics that a lead optimization campaign would have to address, which ends up taking more time and more resources to arrive at a drug candidate that can be administered to a mouse model. So in this manner, by using model organisms, whole animal model organisms in the screening process, which are set to mirror the mutational variants of the disease, we have a real chance to bring precision drugs to market with higher efficiency and lower costs. So, with that background, the first disease that we were interested in studying was Niemann Pick Type C disease. It is a hereditary lysosomal storage disorder caused by mutations in the NPC1 gene. This particular gene codes for a protein that is required for cholesterol trafficking from the lysosomes to different parts of the cell. When this particular gene is defective, the protein coded by it is obviously defective, and therefore cholesterol is no longer able to be trafficked out of the lysosome. Biopsies from patients suffering from this disease show trapped cholesterol in these cell organelles called lysosomes. NPC disease has a very high mortality, specifically in teenage years, leading into early adulthood. It is a rare genetic disease in that there's about 200 patients suffering from this disease within the US. Currently, there's no FDA-approved therapeutic And building on this information, we also noted that the NPC gene has homologs preserved in model organisms of our interest, namely yeast, C. elegans, Drosophila, and as well as mice. So with this in mind, we basically identified mutational variants associated with NPC and created nematode models as well as fruit fly models bearing the disease mutation. And when we did so, we found that they also manifested a developmental or growth phenotype. So once we engineered NPC disease in our model organisms, because they presented with these different kinds of phenotypes, we were able to conduct a discovery screen using a novel chemical library. So we were able to identify compounds that reversed the phenotypic defect associated with the disease mutation in each model organisms. Chemical hits or screen hits that made it through these primary screens were also validated in patient cells. And once this was done, we conducted a rigorous in vitro pharmacokinetic profiling assay, and we were then ready to basically test the effects of our lead candidate in a mouse model of Niemann Pick Type C. So, Niemann Pick Type C has been studied for over 2 to 3 decades. There are about 3 different model systems, mouse model systems, that have been generated for Niemann Pick Type C disease. The oldest and most characterized model is perhaps the Niemann Pick disease NIH model that was published on in 1997. This particular model bears a gene deletion, an NPC gene deletion. The severity of phenotype associated in this particular model is very high. So this particular mouse model survives only up to 3 months of age, and during which time it also presents with very early onset motor degenerative disease, as well as liver and lung abnormalities. So next I'm going to talk about some of the preclinical data associated with Niemann Pick Type C knockouts that has been published on over the years. Specifically, the next couple of slides are going to focus on data from a paper in 2002. So this particular graph looks at the weight of NPC mutants as well as wild types on the with advancing age. So on the y-axis you have the weight, and on the x-axis you have the age in number of days postnatal. So as you can see from this graph here, wild types show a nice increase in their weight with advancing age. However, both male as well as female NPC mutant mice show a plateau in weight around day 42, which then begins to decline. The next set of graphs refers to the motor abilities of NPC mutant mice. The graph on the very left represents open field activity recorded on these particular mice. The y-axis refers to the distance covered by the mice, and x-axis displays the time. Again, as you can see over here, wild-type mice show pretty standard open-field exploratory activity, whereas the NPC mutant mice, both males as well as females, show reduced activity, reduced distances covered over the entire time period. The middle graph pertains to data collected with a balance beam assay. And on the y-axis, you have time in seconds, and on the x-axis, again, you have age, postnatal age in days. And again, you can note from this particular graph that NPC, both NPC male as well as female mice with advances in age show reduced performance on the time that they spend on the balance beam itself. Similarly, on the rightmost graph is data from a standard rotor rod assay. On day 35, NPC mutant mice, males as well as females, show slightly lower performance relative to wild types. This difference continues to increase. Basically, their motor abilities continue to degenerate, so that on day 50, they show pretty significant difference compared to their wild type counterparts. More recently, there have been reports of of cyclodextrin, a commonly used solubilizing agent vehicle, basically, for different drugs. It was found that cyclodextrin was capable of reversing some of the phenotypic defects associated with Niemann Pick type C disease. This particular graph shows you that cyclodextrin, a single once a week dose of cyclodextrin, was able to enhance the. I should mention that the dose of cyclodextrin that was administered here was 4,000 milligram per kilogram administered via a subcutaneous route. So, building on this particular foundation, as we were wrapping up our first screening campaign on model organisms, we wanted to establish an NPC mouse model so that we could test Perlara's lead candidates. Our goals were to determine the baseline features of the NPC mutant model, benchmark with the appropriate positive controls where necessary, so we could set the stage for comparing our candidates against them, in this particular case, cyclodextrin. Because we are a startup, we also had other considerations, which included trying to get as much data as we can from a small sample size, trying to get as much high resolution data as we can while keeping costs low. And of course, we don't want to do this in a manner that was humane. So, with these goals in mind, we partnered with a company called Vium. Vium has a number of attributes that made it interesting for our particular project or proposal. So, in addition to the standard behavioral testing capabilities of the standard vivarium and accreditation. Animal facilities have, Vium made use of automated sensorized cages to capture data. So in essence, they had individual rodent cages that were equipped with cameras, with sound recording devices, humidity and temperature control, humidity and temperature sensors, as well as motion capture devices. And what this enabled us to do is to capture a large number of metrics with very minimal intervention. And to do this with on fewer animals. The other advantage that it had is that in addition to its incredible hardware, they had a very easy, sophisticated software system which allowed you to look at the metrics collected in real time. It allowed you to monitor the experiment, the animals in the enrolled in the particular study remotely, and it allowed you to do this in real time, so that if data led us to believe that we needed to change course in terms of number of animals or design, we were able to have those insights and basically improve our decision-making abilities. So before we move ahead, I thought it would be interesting to show what the Vium interface looked like on our end. As I mentioned, each of these cages is equipped with a camera, so you are able to monitor the activity of the animal in your study remotely. All of the data collected on the animal is also stored on a cloud platform. so that you can toggle back through time and essentially look at what the behavior of the animal was, say, a week ago, or 2 days ago, or 2 hours ago. In addition, these graphs here indicate that you were able to capture real-time data that is automatically graphed and displayed in this manner. So you have access to real-time data analytics on every individual animal enrolled in the study. Most importantly, this entire interface is accessible through a regular browser window without any need of additional software proficiency, at least in my case. So that made it really attractive for us, and we were very excited when we started this particular preclinical study with Vium. So what we first wanted to do is to incorporate an NPC mutant colony at Vium and breed and enroll animals from there, and then subject them to the automated sensorized testing available at Vium. So this year is data collected through automated sensorized cages. NPC, the graph on the left here pertains to the body weight data captured from NPC mutants as well as wild-type littermates. On the y-axis, you have the weight in grams. X-axis, you have postnatal age in days. Like we saw like we had noted in literature from previously published studies, NPC mutant animals in our hands also showed decreases in weight around day 40-45. An interesting aspect that we had not banked upon, but we noted through this project, is that on the right hand side you have a graph that displays the daily breathing rate or respiration for wild types as well as NPC mutant animals. There are definitely published reports about NPC mutant animals suffering from compromised liver as well as lung function as with progression of disease. And this graph, as you can see from this graph here, you can see this in the respiratory rate data of the knockout animals. From day 43 onwards, there is a decrease in the respiratory rate observed with NPC mutant animals relative to their wild-type littermates. So this was a novel finding, one that we had not banked upon when we started the study. It was made possible by the use of automated data collection. Next, we saw that our NPC mutant animals did show lower lifespan, shorter lifespan compared to their wild-type animals. In this particular study, we terminated the wild types once they had outlived the knockouts. And therefore, wild types have, you know, as per this graph, they don't live past day 70. But that's because we terminated the study. I should mention over here that the lifespan that we recorded with our NPC mutant mice are in this study are shorter than what is published in literature. In literature, we've seen reports of approximately 3 to 4 months of survival, whereas in our hands, we noted that NPC mutant animals were survived only past 2 months. Part of this is because of the high resolution data that was collected. We were collecting weights automatically, which meant that any drops, reduction in weight greater than 20% on consecutive days was flagged in the system. It triggered an automatic veterinary check, which then led us to the conclusion that it would be inhumane to have animals living longer under those conditions. So animals were euthanized if they lost more than 20% weight consecutive days. This basically points to a difference in methodology, traditional methodology, because in previous studies, weights of NPC mutants were collected on a bi-weekly or weekly basis. So this is an example where high data resolution can serve to inform the course of your future project. We also use traditional behavioral assays to benchmark the disease progression in the NPC mutant animals that we housed at this facility. So we conducted rotarod as well as balance beam assays at different ages. So the graph on the left here is data obtained from animals that were at age postnatal day 35. On the left, on the y-axis is time spent on rotarod, and x-axis shows you the genotypes. And as you can see, the knockouts or NPC null animals show a slight reduction in the time spent on the rotarod even at day 35. And this difference is greatly enhanced at a later stage of the disease on day 50. So the graph on the right is data from day 50 aged animals, and NPC mutant animals spend a significantly lesser amount of time on the rotarod relative to their wild type letimates. Next is a difference in performance on the balance beam assay with advancing age. The top panel here is data collected from day 35 aged animals, and there are two metrics obtained from the balance beam assay that are plotted here. The left is the average retention time on the balance beam, and the right panel shows you the number of sections, average number of sections crossed by the animal when on the beam. So on both these metrics, day 35 aged animals did show a significant difference relative to their wild type counterparts. This difference was greatly enhanced in day 50 animals, as is evidenced from the panel below. So, with this foundation, we undertook a second study with cyclodextrin-treated animals in order to determine if cyclodextrin could be used as a positive control in our for our preclinical testing context, and what kind of correction did it provide for NPC mutants. So this plot over here pertains to survival on NPC mutants treated with cyclodextrin compared against vehicle-treated NPC mutants and vehicle-treated wild-type animals. And as you can see from this graph here, NPC mutant animals treated with cyclodextrin were able to live longer compared to vehicle-treated controls. So I should mention that the dose of cyclodextrin that was used in our assays was also 4,000 milligram per kilogram administered subcutaneously, as reported in literature. This next graph over here shows that cyclodextrin-treated mutant animals were able to maintain their body weights longer than vehicle-treated mutants. So the panel on the left here shows body weight on the y-axis and the time or postnatal day age on the x-axis. And from this graph, it's evident that cyclodextrin-treated animals are able to maintain their weights longer. I should mention over here that this particular graph was plotted with weights that were collected manually, because we ran into a technical snag while collecting automated weights. I put the graph on the right. This is a graph obtained from our previous study where weight was collected automatically, and shows you the difference between weights of wild type as well as knockout animals. Put this graph up in comparison to show that both by the manual method as well as automatic weight sampling method, similar trends in weight loss are maintained between wild type and NPC animals. Okay, next we looked at motor activity in cyclodextrin-treated animals. And for this particular cohort, we dispensed with the traditional behavioral assays and relied entirely on automated sampling to understand how motor activity was affected in the study. And so this graph shows you the daily motion recorded for all the cohorts. On the y-axis, you have motion expressed as velocity, really, in millimeters per second, and on the y-axis you have once again have postnatal day age. And you can see from this graph that vehicle treated wild types and knockout or NPC nulls treated with cyclodextrin tend to overlap, and they are significantly different from vehicle treated NPC mutant animals, which show a decline in motor function with advancing age. Next, we also had the opportunity to assess motion in circadian cycles, and this led us to an interesting finding in that we saw that motion parameters differed significantly for NPC mutants in the dark cycle, but did not differ as much in the light cycle. Further, this also showed us, as you can see from the panel on the left, that cyclodextrin-treated mutant animals were able to recover their motion within the dark phase so that they were comparable to wild types. Next, we also looked at respiration among the different treatment cohorts. From this graph, it appears that cyclodextrin treatment slows the reduction in respiratory rate to later stages of the disease, compared to the NPC mutant animals. So in this particular case scenario, you can see that the cyclodextrin treatment only allows the benefit to be accessed for a certain period of the lifespan, but respiratory rates do go down just that at the later stages of the disease. So once again, we were able to look at this this data in the circadian cycle, and unlike the motion metrics, we find that respiratory rates decline similarly in the dark phase as well as the light phase, and cyclodextrin continues to provide the same level of correction in the dark phase as well as the light phase. Finally, in order to do a holistic comparison of a cyclodextrin treatment in our NPC mutants, we also sampled some many different biochemical metrics in the different treatment cohorts. We found that liver abnormalities were pretty significant in knockout animals, in NPC mutant animals, as early as day 25 and worsening by day 59. In contrast, cyclodextrin-treated mutant animals showed correction of their liver degeneration at day 25 and continue to show this correction at day 60 as well. We also saw a difference in the triglyceride levels recorded from the different treatment groups. So, in summary, we found that automated sensorized cages helped us to collect more data at higher resolution. It allowed us to gain insights at, into our behavioral data that we would not have had otherwise. Furthermore, we were able to conduct these assays with relatively less stress to the animals because they were handled a lot lesser compared to traditional studies. And overall, this allowed us to capture higher quality data. We found that NPC mutant animals, when subjected to traditional behavioral assays, as well as automated recording of metrics, showed parallel trends similar to that reported in literature. This method of high resolution data capture allowed us to uncover two new metrics, namely circadian motion as well as respiration. We can hope to exploit this particular these particular parameters in our future studies to benchmark disease progression and treatment. We were also able to demonstrate that cyclodextrin, a widely accepted positive control, was able to rescue the reported disease phenotypes in NPC animals as well as additional hitherto unreported phenotypes. And in there were additional metrics that I have not been able to report on over here that also showed positive indicators of being raised in an automated environment. Namely, we saw better breeding rates relative to that recorded in literature. We saw better Mendelian progeny ratios relative to that recorded in literature, as well as rapid response to health checks, which allowed us to conduct our study in a humane manner. So this brings me to our future directions. We are at the stage where we've identified a lead candidate, Perl 101, which has unique properties that make it amenable for the next phase of preclinical studies. Now that our NPC colony is established and benchmarked, we will be embarking on dosing and experimentation paradigms for this particular candidate, and we hope to identify additional metrics to complement traditional phenotypes. And with that, I am happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Iyer, for that informative presentation. Before we get started on the question and answer session, I would like to remind our audience how to submit questions. You can submit questions by typing them in the Q&A box, which can be found by clicking on the green Q&A button at the lower left of the presentation window. We'll try to answer as many questions as we can. If we are unable to get to your question due to time constraints, Dr. Iyer will be answering your questions via email following the presentation. Okay, Dr. Iyer, our first question is, can you summarize the different behavioral endpoints that automated cage recording data can be extrapolated to?
Sure. To begin with, I suppose some of these would obviously be along the lines of what I've presented. So we saw that video recording data from cages could be used to extract different kinds of motion metrics that could then be extrapolated to open field activity, can be extrapolated to general locomotor exploratory behavior. We did find parallels to rotor rod activity as well. There are some other interesting ideas that we did speak about, namely novel object recognition. So it's possible to put novel objects within the cage environment itself and record the amount of time that the animal spends with the novel object. We can also incorporate spinning wheels within the cages and get a better understanding of activity levels as well as gait in particular diseases. We can also incorporate horizontal ladders or beams within the cages, which can allow you to monitor balance beam type data. All of these kinds of data would be pertinent to any kind of movement disorder. In addition, as I've already mentioned, we were able to also look at respiration and weight as well as circadian activity. I think there is a very large number of behavioral assays that can be accessed by using automated systems. But one important aspect is for every model system, it might be important to benchmark, like we have done, what traditional behavioral systems can capture and how that compares with data collected from automated recording systems. And this may be different for different models. And one thing that will enhance our confidence is the number of studies that are conducted on these automated sensorized systems, the more we will be able to collect more historical information on correlations. And eventually, I can see that the field might benefit from moving towards these kinds of systems entirely.
cost of automated data collection compare against traditional intervention-based animal studies?
So that's a great question. This was definitely a consideration that was very important to us early on. And there's a couple different ways of looking at this. One aspect is because this particular type of study allows you to intervene lesser. You have to spend less time conducting traditional behavioral assays and simply rely on capturing data from recording essentially home cage or home environment activity. So because the interventions are lower, that does work to your benefit in the economics of conducting the assay. The other thing that makes this economically accessible is that data storage systems and cloud analytics costs for these kinds of services are also coming down. So it becomes feasible for you to store a large quantity of data and conduct analytics on it without any losses of speed or time. And so these are also, because the amount, the sheer volume of data collected in these assays is very high, those considerations also were important for us. But overall, we found the cost to be very comparable to an assay that you might conduct using traditional methods. If anything, our experience was that we were able to get higher quality data and a number of other metrics that we might have missed out on had we limited ourselves to just a number of traditional behavioral assays. So in the grand scheme of things, I would say the cost is very comparable and trending towards being driven lower.
We are almost out of time and we have time for one last question. But as a reminder, Dr. Iyer will be answering questions via email following the presentation. Okay, Dr. Iyer, our last question is, what are some of the possible drawbacks of using automated cage recording based data?
So there's definitely some drawbacks associated with these automated high-resolution data methods. And one of them, we encountered two of them basically in our experience. So one was because of the frequency of sampling, you might find that you are capturing endpoints or data that are at odds with what is published in literature. And part of that is because when data is sampled by traditional methods, it is fundamentally different. In our case, we found that the with automated cage weighing, we definitely got more up-to-date information about the weights of animals and specifically the decline of weights of our NPC mutant animals. We had to make a decision to terminate our study when they failed our humane condition or body condition score criteria. And this puts you at odds with what is published out there because, like I mentioned during my talk, previous literature on NPC mutant animals seemed to suggest that animals were weighed more intermittently. And so perhaps there was a recovery period that allowed those animals to grow longer. In our hands, we were not able to wait for that opportunity. We felt it was inhumane to consider given the consecutive day weight loss. So we elected to humanely euthanize. This argument will extend to behavioral data as well, which is one of the reasons we did conduct traditional behavioral studies as well and found what were the points of correlation for the data that was sampled automatically. And I think that's an important process to go through. Otherwise, you may be at risk of capturing new and different kinds of data on a completely different system that puts you at odds with published literature. So that's one of the current drawbacks. However, I see because more and more groups are beginning to consider the benefit and the value of conducting traditional assays, rather conducting these assays on automated systems, we might find more and more publications that come out with automated systems, or we might find more publications that speak about the correlation between traditional behavioral metrics and trade-offs with an automated system. So once that kind of data becomes more available, we will be in a position to switch entirely and have that data stand on its own legs. But until that time happens, this high resolution data and the difference in the method of metric collection may require a little bit more defense. The other non-standard experience that we had was like I mentioned, a technical snag. You have the ability to collect a ton of data using automated sensors, but because you are not, you may not be sampling everything personally, you have to have a really robust infrastructure to make sure that there isn't any loss of data, because in certain cases, it might be very hard to recover this kind of data.
I would like to once again thank Dr. Sangeetha Iyer for her presentation. Dr. Iyer, do you have any final comments for our audience?
Well, thank you, LabRoots, for this wonderful opportunity. And yes, please do email me with any additional questions. I'm happy to engage in a dialogue on this particular topic. It's one of great interest to me.
Thank you, Dr. Iyer. I would also like to thank our sponsor, LabRoots, for making today's educational webcast possible. Today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through May 8, 2017. You will receive an email from LabRoots alerting you when this webcast will be available for replay. We invite you to forward that announcement to your colleagues who may have missed today's live event. Thank you for joining us, and we hope to see you next time. Goodbye.